I must admit that sometimes I have misgivings in the way we celebrate Palm Sunday in the life of the church. On the one hand, who doesn't like a good parade? Who doesn't like the children and youth processing in, waving palm branches while we sing Hosanna, loud Hosanna? But on the other hand, the way the liturgy has developed over the years gives the impression that Jesus entered Jerusalem triumphantly, that the parade continued. But that would be further from the truth. For all three Gospels are clear that the parade stopped before Jesus entered Jerusalem. N.T. Wright says that sometimes people get upset with him when he points out what the text actually says rather than what people think it says. And that would be true with how we've come to understand Palm Sunday as a triumph, when in reality, it's a tragedy in the making, a Greek tragedy. Marcus Borg and Dominic Crossan have written an excellent book entitled The Last Week. In that book, they point out that on Palm Sunday, there were not two processions. There were not one, but two processions, one from the east and one from the west. The one from the east came proclaiming the kingdom of God and the Pax Christus. The one from the west came proclaiming the power of Imperial Rome and the Pax Romana. Let's hear how they describe those two processions. Two processions entered Jerusalem on a spring day in the year 30 AD. It was the beginning of the week of Passover, the most sacred week of the Jewish year. One was a peasant procession, the other an imperial procession. From the east, Jesus rode a donkey down the Mount of Olives, cheered by his followers. On the opposite side of the city, from the west, Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor of Idumea, Judea, and Samaria, entered Jerusalem at the head of a column of imperial cavalry and soldiers. Jesus' procession proclaimed the kingdom of God. Pilate's proclaimed the power of empire. The two processions embody the central conflict of the week that led to Jesus' crucifixion. The powers that be prefer Caesar's peace to that of Jesus. And because of that, Jesus understands that his life is fraught with danger, that he is a marked man. This would explain why he no longer publicly preaches out in the open, because he knows that the powers that be would like nothing more to arrest him. This would explain why Jesus has two of his followers to go ahead to secure the donkey for the processional. Because if Jesus were to go into the village of Bethany and Bethphage, he would have been arrested. So he has arranged for a predetermined sign that when he goes when the two disciples go and get the donkey that has never been ridden on, that only a king can ride a donkey that's never been ridden on. That when he goes and gets the donkey, they'll ask him, "And what are you doing?" And the sign, predetermined sign, is this: the Lord needs it. And so the owner of the donkey let it go, because he understands what it will be used for. Jesus is making use of the symbolic of that day. He's well aware of the prophecy in Zechariah. It's part of our call to worship. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he." And so, Jesus instructs his disciples and followers to lay palm branches and cloaks before him. And in Luke's version of the gospel, they say, "Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord." And Mark's version is, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." And Matthew is, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." But Luke is writing to a Gentile audience who's not familiar with Old Testament prophecy about the king who comes riding on a donkey. So he makes it plain for the Gentiles and has the crowd saying, "Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord." Now, the people that day who were not part of Jesus' inner circle would have thought that he's coming as a conquering hero. And the reason why I say that is because some 30 years earlier, Judas Maccabees came riding on a donkey, and they laid palm branches before Judas Maccabees after he defeated the power of the Sucalids. They hailed him as a conquering hero. Jesus is aware of that. That parade began at Mount of Olives. And Judas Maccabees, in many ways, was declaring that, "I am the Messiah, the one who ushers in the Messianic reign." And there were other would-be Messiahs that came and challenged the power of Rome and failed. And so there was great history with this. And so the people were very excited that Jesus is coming as their conquering hero. But he's riding a beast of burden. He's coming in humility. He's coming in peace. We have a choice between the way of Caesar and the way of Christ. The way of Caesar says might makes right. The way of Christ is the way of humility and love and forgiveness. Jesus is not coming as the conquering hero. This would explain why the parade stops before he gets into Jerusalem. If it were to continue, he would have confronted the power of Rome in all its might, and people would have died at the hand of the sword, and Jesus would have been arrested. So the parade disperses. And the first thing Jesus does is go to the temple, and he scouts it out. And what he's looking for in the temple is, where are the soldiers? And where can I overturn the money changers' table to demonstrate how the religious powers are in cahoots with the political powers? Remember what Jesus will say? He will overturn the money changer's table and he will pronounce judgment upon the temple. He will say, it is written that my house shall be a house of prayer. You have made it into a robber's den. A robber's den is where the thieves come back to divide up the loot. It's a place of safety. Jesus is decrying the practice in which the religious leaders allow the political leaders to, through excessive taxation of the poor, take the poor's ancestral land, the land that was given to them when their forebears came into the promised land. This is not how God intended. He delivered them from the power of Pharaoh, not for them to be subjugated again by the power of Caesar. And so Jesus gets up to Jerusalem and has lament. He cries over because he knows what awaits. Rejection awaits. Death and destruction awaits. Not only his death, but so many others. Because they did not recognize the things that make for peace. They did not recognize the hour of God's visitation. Do you remember when God visited another city in the Old Testament? Does the city of Sodom and Gomorrah ring a bell? Remember when God paid a visit through the angels? What followed because they did not recognize that visit? Death and destruction. Jesus said, not one stone will be turned upon another. In 70 AD, the city of Jerusalem was destroyed by the Romans, and not one stone was left, not unturned. And so I guess the question that we should be asking ourselves today is this: have we failed to recognize the things that make for peace? What do you think? I think in many ways, the powers that be that run the world still prefer Caesar's way to Jesus' way. Do you not? And so, you know, I must admit, I am comfortable with our nation's military and with our nuclear weapons. But I'm not so comfortable with countries like North Korea having nuclear weapons, or countries like Pakistan having nuclear weapons, or maybe even Iran, or the Soviet Union, I should say Russia, I should say China. What I'm saying is this: we still prefer Caesar's way. Might makes right, but Caesar's way really does not have the power to bring peace. It only has the power to lessen open hostilities. But it doesn't have the power to change and convert the human heart. Only Jesus can do that. And so from my point of view, the church is needed as much today as it was the day Jesus entered into Jerusalem. We need to recognize the things that make for peace when the human heart accepts Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, when the human heart learns the way of Jesus, the way of humility, the way of sacrificial love, the way of forgiveness, even of one's enemies. This is what Jesus would have us be about. Paul will say, God was in Christ reconciling the world back to God's self and has given us the church a ministry of reconciliation. Not only does the church have the mission to share the good news of the gospel, to convert the human heart, if we're going to save humanity, but the church also has the role to be that only group who cries out in praise of what God has done, is doing, and will do in Jesus. Psalm 118 says, the builder, the stone that the builders rejected, has become the chief cornerstone. It is marvelous in our eyes of what God has done. The Pharisees tried to stop the people from saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. And Jesus says, if the praise stops, the stones will cry out. Our message today is we are given the task to convert hearts of stone into hearts of flesh that beat in sync with the will of God. And the will of God is the way of Jesus. Let us bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. For he is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Prince of Peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.